morning again. So I feel like just about every other week, the sermon illustration that comes to my mind is a sermon illustration about how bad I am at driving. So I don't know. Maybe you guys are learning to never get in a car with me, but one of the things about how bad I am at driving is I get lost so easily. Because I just want to say, y'all, I grew up in Kansas, and by the time Kansas was settled, people had learned how to make grids. So you could go in a straight line and you would end up where you were at. But out here in South Carolina, you know, you can't, there's no such thing as a straight road. And so that mindset of moving from Kansas to South Carolina has just totally, it took me years to figure out like where to go. And usually I just end up getting lost. In fact, one of the first times that Dylan and I spent time alone together was in high school. We were trying to get to a Bible study at one of our friend's house. And this friend lived out in the country in a place that I'd never really been before. And we had his map, we had his address, but neither Dylan and I had a smartphone. So I had gone on to MapQuest and I actually had to print out directions. and those directions were not helping us at all. Because, you know, Dylan wasn't from Kansas, and so he didn't know any of the road names. And he was trying to give me directions, but he wouldn't see the road name until it was, like, time for us to turn, so I would miss the turn. So it was just, I mean, it was just a mess. Like, I had just gotten my license probably that summer. And, you know, we were just both so frustrated. And honestly, looking at that memory, it's probably a miracle that we're married today, because we were just so mad at each other and like just frustrated, because when you're lost, like when you don't know where you are, it's almost like a scary feeling. Like even if you know you're perfectly safe, it's just like, what if I never find where I'm supposed to go? Like, can you imagine having that feeling? Like if you've ever been lost, you know what I'm talking about. Like, and can you imagine having that feeling all of the time? And there are people that actually deal with that on a regular basis. There's actually a brain condition called developmental topographical disorientation, or DTD. And people with this brain condition, they actually struggle, or they physically can't hold a compass in their head. And so even if they're looking straight at the sun, they can't tell, you know, where's north, where's south, where's east, and where's west. And if you give them directions, you know, they physically cannot do it. Like there are connections in the brain that we make every day that are constantly telling us where we're at. And when we see a landmark, usually like a healthy brain can see, okay, I know that landmark, and I know that if I go this way after that landmark, then I can get home. But people with this condition, if they see a landmark, they may know they're in the area, but they have no way which way to turn. And so as I was researching this condition, I read about this woman named Mary McLaurin, and she is 62 years old. And so she, you know, she found out that she had this condition way before GPSs and cell phones. And she talked about the first time she realized, like, there's something wrong with her. She was about 12 or 13 years old, and she was walking her neighbor's dog. And she was about a block away from the house, and she realized, I have no idea which direction to turn. And she realized, or she said in her account of that story, like it was just a wild guess. You know, any direction she chose might have been getting her closer to home, but it was just as likely to be getting her further away. And so finally, she happened to come across a woman who recognized the dog and was able to get her back to the owner's house. But that's when she realized, you know, something is seriously wrong. And so eventually she learned that she has this DTD, and she was able to get some help. But in her own words, she says, I don't know whether I've spent more time hopelessly lost within miles of my own home or trying to explain to people why I cannot follow a simple set of directions. People cannot understand how it's possible to always be completely and utterly lost. And as I think about that woman, and as I think about, you know, what it would be like to never have an eternal compass and to never know where you are on this world, I think about the fact that, you know, honestly, most of us in this room, at least not to my knowledge, none of us in this room have this condition. You know, we may be bad with directions, but at the end of the day, we can still kind of figure out where we're going in life, or where we're going, you know, how to get to the store. But I would venture to guess that even though we don't have this condition, we've all been lost at one point or another. We've all, at some point, needed a map or a GPS or a smartphone nowadays to tell us where to go. And you know, we have these tools, we have these physical guidance, like a GPS or a map, but so often we seem to forget that we also have a spiritual tool to tell us where to go in life. You know, we don't always know what the future holds. When it comes to our lives, we might as well all have DTD, because honestly, we never know which way we're going, right? You may think that you're going in the right direction, and you may realize that's gotten me further along in the path that I meant to. So we all need some kind of spiritual guide to guide us in the right direction. Now, if you've been with us for the past couple of weeks, or if you've put together that you're in church, you probably know that the answer to this question of who our guide is of course, Jesus. And we've been talking over the past couple of weeks about these seven statements that Jesus made. They're called the I Am statements, and they're basically just statements about who he is. The first week, we looked at how he is the bread of life and how he can nurture us and fulfill every need that we have. And then last week, we looked at how he is the light of the world and how he wants to open our spiritual eyes and heal our spiritual blindness so that we can see those around us. And so this week, we're going to talk about the bold claim that Jesus is the Good Shepherd. So we're going to be in John chapter 10 if you want to turn there. And if you're familiar with this passage, or as you're reading it today, you may notice that he actually makes two statements in this chapter. The first one is, I am the door, and he's referring to a sheepfold. Some translations say, I am the gate. And we're not really going to unpack that one today. That one's going to be saved for next week. But this week we're going to look at his claim, I am the Good Shepherd. So if you want to follow along, like I said, we'll be in John chapter 10. You're willing to follow, you're able to follow along on smartphones or your phone or on your Bible, and it'll also be on the screen. But we'll be picking up in verse 11. So this is Jesus talking, and he says, I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me, just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father. So Jesus makes a lot of claims in those seven verses. So we're going to unpack it a little bit. But the first thing that really sticks out to me is, you know, I grew up in church, and so I probably spent more time than the average person thinking about a shepherd. But the reality is, outside of church culture, how many times do you just have a conversation about what a shepherd does? You know, I mean, like, we talk about it in church because of all the references in the Bible to shepherds. But the reality is, the idea of a shepherd is very foreign to us. I mean, I personally don't know any shepherds, and if you know any, I'd love to hear about it, and I'd love to hear what it's like to be a modern-day shepherd. But the reality is, you know, we don't really understand what it was like to be a shepherd in Jesus' day good shepherd did. But to Jesus' audience, to the people he was talking to, a lot of them probably were shepherds or personally knew shepherds. Because shepherds and sheep were a huge part of ancient Jewish culture. I mean, they were used for food, they were used for clothing, they were used for sacrifices in the temple. And so they were everywhere. You know, it was almost, I've seen a lot of commenters refer sheep to cars. You know, of course people didn't ride sheep, but just the abundance of it, how you just see cars everywhere. That's kind of how people were about sheep. Like, they would just see flocks of sheep all over the place. And so Jesus, when he says, "I am the good shepherd," he's immediately drawing up images for the Jewish people. But another thing that he's doing, because the shepherd was such common, was so common to these people, God actually refers to himself as the good shepherd all throughout the Old Testament. This declaration that Jesus is making is nothing new. In fact, you know, we've talked about how every I am statement that Jesus is making somehow connects him to the divine. Every I am statement that Jesus makes is a claim that he is God. And so when people heard Jesus say, "I am the good shepherd," some of these passages would have come into their heads. The first one would be Psalm 23:1, or a Psalm of David. Some of us may know it, but the very first verse says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing." And then in Isaiah 40, verse 11, as I turn to it here, God refers to himself and he says, "He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young." And then in Ezekiel 34, verses 14 and 15, God again is speaking, and this whole chapter is just beautiful imagery. The Israelites have been led by false shepherds. That's what God refers to them as, these religious leaders who have not been doing their job. Instead of caring for the sheep, they've just been using the religious system to fill their own pockets. And so finally God is saying, no more. No more of these false shepherds. No more of these hired men. That I am going to come and I am going to lead my sheep. And so he says in verses 14 and 15, "I will tend them in a good pasture, and the mountain heights of Israel will be their grazing land. There they will lie down in good grazing land, and there they will feed in a rich pasture on the mountains of Israel. I myself will tend my sheep and have them lie down," declares the Sovereign Lord. And so what Jesus is saying as he declares, "I am the good shepherd," the very first thing that he's saying is, not only is he using that Yahweh that we've been talking about, you know, that phrase, "I am," which to the Israelites would immediately register that image of Moses in the burning bush and God saying, "I am that I am." So not only is he using that Yahweh phrase, but he's also using this phrase, "the good shepherd," to declare, "Look, I'm in. You know, I know the Father and the Father knows me because I am God." And so Jesus is here declaring that he's our good shepherd. And he's declaring that he has the power to be our good shepherd because he is God. In fact, when a Sunday school teacher once asked her young class, you know, "What makes a good shepherd?" One of the little kids piped up and they said, "Well, he picks up his sheep when they fall down." Right? I mean, that's what a good shepherd does. When a sheep is in trouble, when one of God's people is in trouble, God leans down and he picks them up. And that's what God does for each one of us. Right? And God cares for all of his people. In the Old Testament times, it was really difficult, but not impossible, but it was difficult for someone who wasn't of the line of Abraham, someone who wasn't born Jewish, to become Jewish. Like, it was possible, but there were all these rules that they had to go through, and they had to follow these certain rituals, and then they could be accepted in into the kingdom of God. But Jesus is ushering in a new era with this declaration that he is the good shepherd. And what he's saying is that now salvation is for everyone, right? It came out of the Jews. God used the Jews to be an example to the world. That was the whole intent, was they were to be an example to the world of how much God loves his people. But now salvation is for everyone. And Jesus, as God wrapped in humanity, is simply creating a path for anyone, anywhere, to be a child of God. And so when he connects himself to the good shepherd of the Old Testament, what he's saying is that same good shepherd that picks up his sheep when he falls down is now available to every single one of us. Isn't that something to celebrate? I mean, the God of the Old Testament is our God today. We don't have to jump through the same hoops anymore. All we have to do is simply accept that the good shepherd laid down his life for us. That's all we have to do. And so another thing that really sticks out to me is how much good shepherds protect their sheep. In fact, that's the first blank if you want to go ahead and fill it in. Good shepherds protect their sheep. And I know that because of looking at verses 14 and 15, where Jesus says, "I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me, and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep." Right? Because not only does Jesus protect us, but he knows us intimately. And sometimes when we think about how intimately Jesus knows us, there's a little bit of a pushback. Like, surely the God of the universe doesn't love me that much. Right? Surely that's just romanticizing this relationship. But he says right there in verse 15, "I know my sheep just as I know the Father." And if you think about the intimacy between Jesus and the Father, I mean, so often we struggle to separate them because they're so close. They're part of the same Godhead, right? And so they know each other. They've been together since the beginning, since before the beginning of time. They know each other better than anyone or anything could ever know another person. And Jesus is saying, "I know my sheep just as well as the Father knows me." And so not only does he know us, but he knows how to protect us. Because by knowing us, he knows exactly what our faults are. He knows which cliffs we want to jump off of and which ones we'll stay away from. Right? He knows what's going to hurt us. Because everyone bruises differently. Right? Something that might hurt your friend might be okay to you. You know, you might be able to handle different hardships, but there are some things that, even if they don't look that hard to someone else, maybe they're going to hurt you deeply. Maybe because of your past, or maybe just because of the way that you're wired. And the beautiful thing is, Jesus knows that, because he knows you intimately. And because he knows you, and because he is God the Father, he has the ability to protect you from those things. Now, he may not always protect us in the way that we want him to. He may not stop those things from happening, but he still has the ability to protect our heart if we entrust it to him. And so that's what he's saying this morning, is that the good shepherd protects his sheep. And so that's not a promise that you're never going to face hardship. If you've been alive for 5 minutes, you know that being a Christian doesn't mean you'll never face hardship. In fact, sometimes when we become a Christian, what we're doing is we're saying to the devil, "Hey, I'm an enemy now, come at me." But what God is saying is, look, the devil is going to try to attack you. You know, he's trying to hurt you to get to me. And so I'm going to protect you. Because a good shepherd protects his sheep. And in fact, in ancient times, it was really common, I found this really interesting, it was really common for like 3 or 4 shepherds. They would take their sheep out in the day, and they would graze them, they would try to find, you know, food and water for the sheep. But at night, they would all bring their sheep into one fold. And so you'd have like four or five different flocks of sheep all intermingling with one another. And this was before collars or branding or anything like that. And so in the mornings, the way that the shepherds would separate their sheep is they would simply call them. And the sheep knew the shepherds so well that they could simply recognize their shepherd's voice and they would go to him. So how well do you know the voice of your shepherd? Is the shepherd trying to speak to you? Is he trying to tell you something that you simply can't recognize as his voice? And if that's you this morning, if you think that maybe God is trying to tell you something and you're not sure if it's God or if it's other voices, then maybe it's time to spend some more time with your shepherd and time to start getting to know his voice. Because Jesus knows you intimately and he wants you to know him just as much as he knows you. And so I would encourage you, if you have a hard time listening to your voice, to the voice of God, spend some more time with him. In fact, you know, that's why I talk about being lost, is because the Good Shepherd wants to guide us. He guides us and he protects us. And not only does he do that, but he also saves us. In New Testament and Old Testament times, the people that Jesus was talking to, they were really used to the sacrificial system, right? They understood that if I sin, even if it's unintentional, something has to die in my place, right? That was one thing that had been nailed into their heads by the time that Jesus came to earth, is if I sin, if I mess up, something has to die. And so to the people, sheep laid down their lives all the time. Not willingly, but they had to lay down their lives in order for the people to live. But the beautiful thing about our Good Shepherd is that he lays down his life for us. It says in verse 11, "I am the Good Shepherd. The Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." And so what Jesus is doing is he's taking their paradigm, their outlook on life, and he's completely flipping it around. And he's saying, look, all these things that you thought you knew, I'm here to change your mindset and to tell you that now I'm laying my life down for you. And because I'm the Good Shepherd, because I'm the same God of the Old Testament, I have the power to do that. Right? I'm not just making empty promises, but I can actually do that because of who I am. And so the Good Shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. And in case you haven't picked up right now, by now, you are that sheep. You are the one that Jesus laid down his life for. And I love that Jesus emphasizes that no one took his life, but he laid it down willingly, and he is the one who took it up again. He is the one who resurrected himself. And he did that for each and every one of us. He carried our burdens, our shame, my sin, my burdens, my shame. He carried them to the cross for each and every one of us. You know, for the past couple of weeks, we've been looking at how after Jesus makes an I am statement, he usually does a miracle. Like when he said, I am the bread of life, he said that right after he had multiplied the bread and fed the 5,000. And last week when he said, I am the light of the world, he then went and healed a man born blind and gave that man light. And so this week when he says, I am the good shepherd, the miracle to prove that is the resurrection, the crucifixion and the resurrection. And so I just want to challenge us this morning, you know, maybe we don't necessarily think about the fact that the Good Shepherd laid down his life for each and every one of us. And you know, Jesus, as he's saying these words, we're only about 8 chapters away from his arrest. And a lot happens in those 8 chapters, but the reality is, throughout all of Jesus' ministry, everything that he came to do was all framed by him going to the cross. cross for each and every one of us. And the reality is, you know, when Jesus was on this earth, he said some great things. He did some great things, and he set a good example. But the main reason that he came was to die on the cross for us, to lay down his life for us. And that's the whole reason for the Old Testament sacrificial system. You know, sometimes as we read the Old Testament and we see all of these rules about how to slaughter animals and what animals match what sins, it can be really confusing, and we can think, you know, what kind of God would declare that something else has to die for my sins? You know, what kind of God would think that it's fair for an innocent lamb to be slaughtered and his blood to be spilled so that I can be forgiven? Right? Like, that doesn't make sense. But the whole reason for that Old Testament system was to prepare people for the idea that one sacrifice will outdo all of the other sacrifices. And so that's the reason that we no longer do sacrifices today, even though we have those in our scripture. We no longer do sacrifices because Jesus came to fulfill the law. And that's what he was fulfilling. And so that is how deeply you are loved. You are loved deeply enough that before the beginning of time, God knew that you would be born. He knew that you would need a sacrifice. And he knew that if he came out of the blue, you wouldn't understand it. And so he knew that he had to set up the system that sometimes seemed unfair and could get caught up in rules and regulations. But it was the only way to teach us that this one sacrifice is the way. That is how deeply you are loved, that this was all planned out from the very beginning. And as Jesus is having these conversations, a lot of commenters think that he's standing either in the court of the Gentiles or the court of the women in the temple in Jerusalem. And so what that would mean is the temple, the way it was set up, was there are certain barriers that would block certain people from getting into the next level. And so on the very outside of the temple was what is referred to as the court of the Gentiles. And so those God-fearing men and women who hadn't taken those steps to become a Jew, who hadn't been circumcised, they were allowed only this far. And then Jewish women were allowed a step further. And then Jewish men, and then the priests, and then the high priest. But what Jesus is saying as he's looking out at the court of the Gentiles, he is looking at each one of them who aren't allowed any further in. And as he's looking at them, he declares, "I have other sheep that are not of the sheep pen. I must bring them also. And they too will listen to my voice, and there will be one flock and one shepherd." And so the third thing that Jesus does, he protects us, he saves us, and he unites us. And so no more will there be that separation in the flock of Christ. Right? Because all of us, anyone who listens to his voice, can go all the way to the Holy of Holies. Anyone who hears his voice and follows it can be a part of his flock. So it doesn't matter if you're a Jew or a Gentile or a Wesleyan or a Baptist, or if you're white or if you're black or if you're a citizen or if you're an immigrant or if you're a Democrat or a Republican, we are all in the same footing with Jesus as our shepherd. In fact, there is only one church in Spartanburg County. We meet at different locations, we look different, but any church that preaches that Christ came and died for each one of us is our church. And any person, no matter what they look like, that proclaims that Christ died for me is our brother or sister. And any person that doesn't proclaim that, and any church that doesn't proclaim it, they're just not in our fold yet. They are our mission, right? Because when Jesus came, he came to bring everyone into his fold. He came to bring unity where religion had brought disunity. He came so that we could all stand on equal footing with him. And the reality is, if he hadn't come, none of us in this room would be on that equal footing. Because we are those Gentiles who would have been in the outer court, right? We wouldn't have been let in any further. And so now that we've been given the ability to follow Jesus and to know him intimately, just as the Father knows him, now that we've been given that ability, it's now up to us to bring that same good news to everyone around us. Jesus' vision for the church was that we would stand united as one. And so as we're leaving this morning, let's leave with a renewed vision to seek out those who have not been brought into the fold yet. Because as sheep under the great shepherd, it is our responsibility to go out and not to bring others into the fold. We are not responsible for others' salvation, but we are responsible to make sure that they know that there is a God who loves them. And it is our responsibility to make sure that they know that we are following that God. So as we leave this morning, let's remember who our shepherd is, what he's done for us, and how deeply loved we are by him. And if you're here this morning and if you're really struggling with decisions that are coming up, or if you're really struggling with an area in your life or a burden that you just don't think you can carry on your own, let Jesus be the good shepherd in that scenario. Let him be the one to guide you. Let him be the one to carry that burden for you. Or better yet, let him be the one to carry you through that circumstance. Because you are more loved than you could ever possibly imagine. You are loved as deeply as the Father loves the Son. You are loved as deeply as the Father loves the Son. So let's pray to our good shepherd this morning. Father, as we come before you this morning, God, we thank you that you are the good shepherd. We thank you that you laid down your life for us in the form of Jesus. God, we thank you that there's nothing that we did to earn it. There's nothing that we did to make us lovable, other than simply being created. God, we thank you that you gave us your image. We thank you for your love. God, I know that it's easy to forget just how deeply loved we are. It's easy to go through life and to have things come up that get in the way, that maybe make us question your love. But God, I pray that you would just remind us this morning that those things, while they matter and while they are real, they can't hurt us. They can't hurt our spirit because you are our protector. God, we thank you that the image of the good shepherd, the imagery that you chose to use to describe yourself, brings up imagery of peaceful waters and plentiful grass and being carried when we're hurt. God, we thank you that you are not a God of judgment. You are not a God of looking down on us, but that you are a God who guides us, who protects us, who saves us, and who unites us. Father, I pray that as we're leaving this morning, that you would help us all remember that we're just sheep in your fold. God, I pray that you would bring unity across our county and across our nation. Because you, as the good shepherd, want us to all be one flock under one shepherd. So God, I pray that you would remind us of that, that you would remind us that we're all brothers and sisters. And if there's anyone in our lives who haven't been brought into the fold, who haven't accepted you as our Savior, God, I pray that you would give us the courage we need to speak words to them about how much they are loved by you. I pray that you would open our eyes to opportunities for those conversations. Because at the end of the day, it's all about how much you love us. Father, thank you for these I am statements. Jesus, thank you for these statements that teach us about who you are. So that we don't have to worship a God that we don't know, but we can worship a God that we can know intimately. And while we'll never fully understand you, God, we thank you that you've given us little tidbits of information about just how great you are. So Lord, I pray that you would just help us to rest in the knowledge that we are intimately loved by you as we go out today. It's in your holy and precious name.